Hello, this is a video on the late romantics and prose writers of Britain. We have talked about the early romantics, Wordsworth, Coleridge and Southey. Now we have to talk about Byron, Shelley, Keats and then another writer, John Clare, and also the novelists and prose writers. Romanticism is not an easily defined concept. We have discussed the different ramifications of romanticism, the different nuances of the term in earlier chapters, in Romantic Revival and the early romantics. The romantic period varies greatly between different countries, different artistic media and different areas of thought. Romanticism in Britain is very different from romanticism in Germany, which is different from romanticism in America, for example. And romanticism in painting is not exactly the same as romanticism in music or literature. Romanticism is there in politics, in philosophy, in the novel, in drama, in poetry, sculpture. These are all different from one another. Romanticism was a more pronounced concept and practice in the Protestant countries like Germany and Britain, because Protestantism gave importance to the individual's relation to God, the individual's relation to meaning. That is what Romanticism also gives importance to. Classicism does not give the individual a lot of freedom, whereas Romanticism does. Naturally, Romanticism is more akin to Protestantism. The Romantic era was a time of war. There was the American Revolution and then the French Revolution. We have seen that already. The French Revolution ended in the Napoleonic Wars. There were lots of political and social problems following these wars. And revolutions broke out in many European countries after this. They are collectively called by the term revolutions of 1830. These are rebellions against conservative kings and governments by liberals and revolutionaries in different parts of Europe. In 1830-32 period, many liberals and revolutionaries in different parts of the world broke out in rebellion against conservatism. So this happened in Belgium, France, Poland, Switzerland, etc. These are the revolutions of 1830. Belgium, France, Poland and Switzerland. Now this is the Emperor Napoleon, a famous painting of the Emperor Napoleon in his study. Napoleon took over the government after the French Revolution and he started war with the neighboring countries. This led to the Napoleonic Wars, which ended with the Battle of Waterloo in 1815. The early romantic visionary optimism and belief in change vanished at this time. The early romantics had a visionary belief in change. They were optimistic. You know that Wordsworth, Coleridge, Southey, etc. were liberals in their youth. It was later that they turned into conservatives. So the early romantic visionary optimism and belief in change vanished in the later period because of the reign of terror in French Revolution especially. And the romantics shared their predecessor's passion for liberty. The later romantics, that is, shared their predecessor's passion for liberty. Both early romantics and late romantics had a passion for liberty. There was a desire to be free of convention and tyranny at this time. They wanted to break free from convention and tyranny. There was a new emphasis on the rights and dignity of the individual. A new emphasis on the rights of the individual, dignity of the individual, freedom of the individual. And a criticism of the bourgeois society. Middle-class bourgeois values began to be criticized. Displays of intense emotion continued. Many early romantics showed intense emotion in their writing, in their music. Later romantics also continued, especially in writers like Shelley. You can see rapturous emotion, intense emotion. There was an experimentation with form and technique that was going on in the early romantic period. It was generally reduced, often replaced with meticulous technique, as in the poems of Tennyson. Romantic ideas about the nature and purpose of art. What is the nature of art? How should art be? You can see Wordsworth talking about it at length in preface to Lyrical Ballads, for example. So romantic ideas about the nature of art and the purpose of art. Is it instruction or delight? Above all, the importance of originality. Do not just follow other people's style. Write originally. All these continue to be important. These preoccupations continued in the late Romantic period. Now, realism and romanticism. The rise of realism marked the end of romanticism. Realism was there before, after the Romantic period. Romanticism was there before realism. Realism marked the end of romanticism. Realism, especially in the novel, it started in France in the works of Balzac, Flaubert, Stendhal, Dickens, etc. And then it was seen in drama, in the new drama of Ibsen and Shaw. Ibsen introduced realism on stage, and in Ibsen's drama, you can see the discussion of social reality. Social problems are discussed in his problem plays. Realism in painting, you can see in Gustave Courbet. Again, a French artist, he depicted rural scenes, countryside scenes. And Francisco Goya, he depicted the realities of the mind, dark realities of society also. In music, there was the tradition of realism found in Verismo opera, which brought the naturalism of Emile Zola and Henrik Ibsen into the opera. Naturalism means it's a kind of realism. It is a branch of realism where human beings are presented as products of their environment. Human beings are behaving in certain ways. Human beings have certain characteristics because of their circumstances. Somebody is angry. Somebody is very cowardly. Somebody is overexcited. Somebody is very passionate. It is not like you are born with all your traits. Many of your traits are acquired. And these traits come from your circumstances. So, this is naturalism. Naturalism was found in Emile Zola, the French writer who wrote Nana. Henrik Ibsen also, the dramatist from Norway. And in music, it came into common practice. Naturalism. And then there is the fact that romanticism never died out completely. It went on in the Victorian period also, continued to flourish in Victorian writers like Tennyson and the Brontes. It was actually the Brontes who first brought romanticism into the English novel. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe was a very important German writer. He was a romantic. And he started his career with a famous novel, The Sorrows of Young Werther. It was not a great novel, actually. It was rather immature, but people loved it. Our Goethe himself did not like it very much. The Sorrows of Young Werther established the cult figure of a young artist with a very sensitive and passionate temperament. It laid the foundations of a very emotional movement called the Sturm und Drang movement, or the Storm and Stress movement. It was a movement of great emotion. We have talked about it in Coleridge before. And this movement also laid the foundations of Romanticism. At that time, Germany comprised many small separate states. Germany was a conglomeration of different small states. And Goethe's works helped to unify these states. He developed a sense of unifying sense of nationalism at this time through his writing. So nationalism is also a romantic trait. In romanticism, in romantic literature, etc., you find nationalism as a very important trait. That was there in Goethe's works. Other romantics in Germany were Johann Gottlieb Fichte, a German idealist, and Friedrich Schelling. Jena was a place where Fichte, Schelling, Hegel, Schiller, and the Schlegel brothers, there were two brothers, August and Friedrich Schlegel. They all were connected with this place, Jena. It became a center for early German romanticism. Other important writers like Tieck, Novalis, and Holderin. Novalis and Holderin are writers who influenced Matthew Arnold. Heidelberg later became a center of German romanticism. When you read a lot of important major books on detailed studies of literary criticism and theory, many times you come across these writers also, their names also. the important motifs in German Romanticism, the recurring symbols or the recurring ideas in German Romanticism were traveling. A lot of people traveled, really physically traveled at this time. They wrote about different places at this time. The beauty of nature is associated with traveling. And also there was at this time the popularity of folk literature and children's literature. Folk literature found its earliest awakenings in historical novels or in fairy tales that began to be written and translated at this time. In the popularity of earlier writers like Shakespeare, you can see folk elements. So the first collection of Grimm's fairy tales by the brothers Grimm was published in the Romantic period, and folk literature also added to the Romantic spirit. There was there were non-classical Germanic myths at this time. Germanic myths became popular at this time, that is, childhood innocence, the importance of imagination, etc., were also important motifs in late motifs in German Romanticism. Late motif itself is a German term that came from Thomas Mann later. Later, German Romanticism was found in E.T.A. Hoffmann, a very major German writer actually, even though we don't know him very well in English departments. He's a very important writer, you should know. E.T.A. Hoffmann has written the book The Sandman or Der Sandman. German Romanticism is darker in its motifs and has more Gothic elements. Dark Romanticism also flourished in some writers in America, such as Nathaniel Hawthorne and Edgar Allan Poe. So, Romanticism in Germany flourished in this manner, and it influenced Britain and later America. The Romantic period in America or the US is roughly from 1830 to 1860. In between the 1850s is called the period of American Renaissance. One decade where there was a lot of flowering in arts and culture and literature. So the Romantic period in the US overlaps with the early Victorian period. Late Romanticism and early Victorianism coincided with the American Romantic period. Major writers in America American romantic writers were James Fenimore Cooper, who wrote the Leather Stocking Tales, such as like Last of the Mohicans, Ralph Waldo Emerson, who was a transcendentalist, so was Henry David Thoreau, there was the poet Emily Dickinson, Margaret Fuller was also a transcendentalist, H.W. Longfellow was a fireside poet and Brahmin poet, Nathaniel Hawthorne was a dark romantic. His friend was Herman Melville. Then Washington Irving, another early writer. Edgar Allan Poe is a Gothic and dark romantic. Walt Whitman. These are all romantic writers in America. It is very wrong to separate American literature and British literature, or British literature and European literature. When you study European literature, you should know the... When you study British literature, you should know the major European writers who influenced that age, the contemporaries in Europe you should know. You should know the American writers also of that age, because they all influenced one another. It was a symbiotic relationship. You should not separate these into different subjects and study them as if they are not related. That is wrong. The American Romantics looked upon nature as a haven or a refuge where the self can fulfill its potential. This idea that nature is good, it is where self can fulfill its potential, that was against the earlier Puritan view that nature is the fallen wilderness full of savage Indians. The earlier view was that nature is fallen, it is wilderness, it is full of savagery. That idea was there earlier in the Puritan period. The Romantics were against this. The American Romantics upheld self-reliant individualism. You can see this expressed in egotistic, futile, destructive actions of heroes such as Captain Ahab in Moby Dick, for instance. They highlighted how self-reliance conflicts with... They highlighted how self-reliance conflicts with social and religious conventions. So Henry David Thoreau's concept of self-reliance, Emerson's concept of self-reliance is deeply romantic. They highlighted how self-reliance conflicts with social and religious conventions. You can see that in Dickinson, Emily Dickinson, as well as in the character Hester Prynne. In which book do you have the character Hester Prynne? In Scarlet Letter. Self-reliant individualism was upheld by the transcendentalists. I told you Emerson wrote an essay, Self-Reliance, and they were radically egalitarian. They believed in equality and they were also politically progressive. These are aspects of self-reliant individualism. They were so individualistic that many writers of this time were even receptive to non-heterosexual relations. You can see such elements in Walt Whitman, Herman Melville, etc. The American Romantics used symbols, myths, or fantasy to convey deeper psychological or archetypal themes. They made a profound use of symbols, myths, fantasy. Why? To convey deeper psychological or archetypal themes. For example, Herman Melville's Moby Dick. Herman Melville's Moby Dick is a symbol. That white whale is a symbol. Walden Pond. Symbolically, Thoreau lived near Walden Pond to see if self-reliance can be practiced. And also, in Edgar Allan Poe's story, such as The Fall of the House of Usher, you can see symbolic use. Use of symbols, that is. Their style is often very original and not rule-bound. The style of the American Romantics is very original, not very rule-bound. You can see this freedom in writing in Emily Dickinson and Walt Whitman. Now let us take a look at the poets themselves. Byron, Shelley, Keats, and then John Clare. Byron, Shelley, Keats, they were the second generation Romantics in England. These three poets were distinct from the Lake School. They were different from the Lake School poets. They formed a group, but not a formal group. There were similarities in their writing. They knew each other. They influenced each other. In a very informal way, they were a group, actually. But they were not a formal school. All these poets were born on the wake of the French Revolution. And none of them were affected directly by the commotion of the revolution. None of these writers were directly affected by the French Revolution. But they were influenced by the ideals, the revolutionary ideals. The major influences on these writers, the late Romantics, are the liberal agitations after 1815, after the Napoleonic Wars ended. There were liberal agitations by the liberals. These influenced the late Romantics. The progress of utilitarianism utilitarianism of John Stuart Mill and others also flourished during this time. They were also influenced by the over two decades of political unrest in Europe. For over two decades, there was political unrest in Europe at this time, which would be followed by the order of the Victorian period. Victorian period gave too much importance to order, but it was preceded by an age of disorder. Wordsworth was also a major influence on the late Romantics. Wordsworth, with whom they had a literary love-hate relationship. These were the influences on the late Romantics. Lord George Gordon Byron, 1788 to 1824 was the lifespan. 1788 to 1824. He was the most flamboyant and notorious of the major Romantics. Byron lived a very flamboyant life and he was also very notorious. He was born in London with a clubbed right foot. He had a club foot. His mother, Catherine Gordon, was a Scottish heiress but impoverished. They didn't have money though. And like his son, her son, she also had bouts of melancholy. His father was Captain Mad Jack Byron. He was like the son, a profligate who squandered his money. The father had another daughter, Augusta, by a previous marriage. That was the stepsister of Byron. And she died, sorry, the father died when the poet's son was only 3 years old. Byron spent his childhood at Aberdeenshire in Scotland. The place, Aberdeenshire. Scottish scenery and Calvinism both influenced him. Scottish scenery and Calvinism. Calvinism is a kind of Christianity, very strict Christianity. He inherited barony and family home. He got the title as well as the home when he was just 10 years old. He was rather immature then, too young to get these, the title and the rich home. This is young Byron, not 10 years old, older than that, of course. Painting of Lord Byron, very handsome. And he was educated at Aberdeen School and later Harrow. It was a famous school for boys. Very famous school, Eton, Harrow. And also later at Trinity College, Cambridge. Here at Cambridge, he was quite notorious for his profligate behavior. He had a few love affairs with both men and women. And he formed lifelong relationships with some men, which probably had a homosexual aspect. His first volume of verse was Fugitive Pieces, a small volume published in 1807. Remember, the first collection of Byron's poetry came in 1807. Some of the poems in this collection are highly amorous. And upon the advice of a friend, Byron burnt all but 4 copies of this book. In the same year, he brought out a miraculously chaste revised edition. Fugitive Pieces came in 1807. It was kind of amorous. In the same year, he brought out another edition. He sat and rewrote it in a chaste manner. And that edition is called Poems on Various Occasions. Poems on Various Occasions. The first distinguished collection, these two early collections were not very distinguished. They didn't become very famous. The first distinguished collection came a few months later, Hours of Idleness. Hours of Idleness was the first major collection by Byron. And it also came in the same year, 1807. And it was titled by Lord George Gordon, Byron, a Minor. He made the disclaimer that he is only a minor poet. He is not adult. The poems were imitative and sentimental. And the preface with pompous mock modesty pleaded the poet's youth and inexperience. Please don't attack me. I am young and inexperienced. Like that. However, he got attacked. Despite all the disclaimer, he was attacked. In 1808, a scathing review of Hours of Idleness appeared in the Edinburgh Review. There was a critical attack on Hours of Idleness in Edinburgh Review. Byron replied with the satire, English Bards and Scotch Reviewers. 1809. It was published by John Murray II, who published all his poems later. English Bards and Scotch Reviewers was an attack on other poets and critics. So, it was published anonymously. When the satire found favorable response from reviewers in the second edition only, his name was mentioned. The poem is an attack on literary innovators and critics who had annoyed him. It is an attack on turgid Coleridge, simple Wordsworth, Sade, and the critic Francis Jeffrey. His enmity with Sade will not end. It will go on for a long, long time after this. And there was a faint praise for Scott and Gregory Monk Lewis. You remember the Gothic romancer. And he endorsed neoclassical virtues of poets like Dryden and Pope. Our Byron at this time was not aware that he is a romantic poet. He endorsed neoclassical values of Dryden and Pope. And this poem was actually written in heroic couplets, like the Augustine poets, modeled on Pope's satirical verse. At this time, it was customary for young men to travel in Europe or other parts of the world. It was called the Grand Tour. They got education and exposure from this such trips. Byron left on a tour in June 1809 after English Bards and Scotch Reviewers. Remember, English Bards and Scotch Reviewers also came in 1809. So that same year, Byron left with his friend John Hobhouse, his intimate friend from Cambridge, whom he called Hobby. Because he had money, he traveled not in Europe, but in the East, in the Middle East, rather than Europe, because of the Napoleonic Wars. And also because he had money. He went from Portugal to Spain, to the Mediterranean region, to Albania, to Athens. And he swam across the Hellespont, which is the Strait of the Aegean Sea in Turkey. It is now called Dardanelles. He also seems to have been attracted to Islam at this time, especially Sufi mysticism. Byron at this time had several sexual encounters, and details of these travels are known through his letters to friends. That was a grand tour of Byron. You see him during the grand tour dressed in Albanian dress. Painting from 1814. I'm not going to read this. I will just tell you what happened. During this time, there is something that happened in the ship that Byron was traveling in. Lord Elgin was transporting marbles from Greece and other Eastern parts of the world to England. He was actually stealing these marbles. In the colonial period, this actually happened a lot. The white people physically brought monuments, etc., from Greece and other parts of the world, paid a pittance and brought monuments. This was happening in the ship that Byron traveled. These are the Elgin marbles in the British Museum. Whole walls and big marble plates they brought like this. Now, after his travels, Byron wrote Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. It is actually a poem in four cantos. The first two cantos only appeared in 1812. It's an account of his Eastern travels written in Spenserian stanza. Spenserian stanza was a very favorite meter among the Romantics. Eve of St. Agnes by John Keats is also in Spenserian stanza. And the first two cantos of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage were published in 1812. Two more cantos appeared in 1816 and 18. This book, Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, made Byron a celebrity. 4,500 copies were sold in less than 6 months. 4,500 copies is a big deal in those days especially. And Byron was himself shocked. He himself was shocked at this response. And he said, famously, "I awoke one morning and found myself famous." He didn't know that he was going to be famous. It was a surprise. At that time, Walter Scott was the best-selling poet of the decade. And Byron beat Walter Scott in popularity. Byron, in this book, Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, offers a view of the Western Mediterranean torn by war and the sad relic of Greece decaying under Ottoman misrule. Greece is decaying under the Ottomans. Childe, C-H-I-L-D-E, means a young knight in training, like a guest lecturer. This Childe Harold is the first Byronic hero. Later we have what is called Byronic hero. Byronic heroes are like Milton's Satan. They are outcasts. They are disturbed people. We will explore that later. The poet's relationship with nature is also explored in Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. Remember, 1812. So 1807, Fugitive Pieces, followed by poems on various occasions. Then he wrote, what did he write? In 1807, Hours of Idleness. Then the critics attacked him in Edinburgh review, etc. And then what happened? He wrote English Bards and Scotch Reviewers. Then Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, two cantos. Two more cantos in 1816-18. After Childe Harold's two cantos appeared, Byron went on to write four popular Oriental tales. He wrote four tales on Oriental themes. The Gaor, The Bride of Abydos, The Corsair, and its sequel, Lara. All these Oriental tales, there is Orientalism at work here. In the Orient, there are only very immoral, negative things. That is what the Westerners thought at that time. Orient corrupts you. All these tales are tales of illicit love, guilt, violence, and death. Why didn't he write any progressive moral tales about the Orient? Because these are Orientalist, to use Edward Said's term. These poems orientalize the themes of the Gothic novel in verse. In 1815, in the midst of affairs, including one with his half-sister Augusta, Byron married Annabella Milbank. Byron got married, but at that time, he had many affairs. There were also rumors of more affairs. There was even the rumor that he's having an affair with his half-sister Augusta. In 1814, on the occasion of Napoleon's exile, just before Waterloo, Napoleon had been defeated and exiled. From there, he came back. Ruled for three more months, and again, after that, he was again defeated. So, during Napoleon's exile before the Waterloo, Byron wrote Ode to Napoleon Bonaparte, which shows ambivalent feelings. In 1815, he wrote Hebrew Melodies, lyrics for the Jewish music composed by one Isaac Nathan. It contains the famous lyric, "She Walks in Beauty." In 1815, Byron was plagued by financial problems, as well as his own drinking and irrational behavior. And convinced that her husband is mad, his wife Annabel left him with their daughter. This was very painful for the poet, especially the legal separation that followed. And the stories of his incestuous relationship with Augusta had spread. He also had started a relationship with Claire Claremont, William Godwin's stepdaughter, Mary Wollstonecraft's daughter, in 1816, the year in which he brought out the third canto of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. Byron left for Geneva in Switzerland with his personal physician, John Polidori. Remember when I talked to you about Frankenstein, I told you that it was in this occasion when Byron was living there with John Polidori that Mary Shelley and P.B. Shelley met him, and they all discussed, and it led to me Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. That is the incident. John Polidori, I had also told you, is the grandfather of D.G. Rosary. And when he reached there in Geneva, he found pregnant Claire waiting for him there along with Mary Shelley and P.B. Shelley. Mary Shelley and Claire are stepsisters. In Geneva in 1816, Byron rented a villa, and all of them spent time together there. It is in this environment that of a genuine friendship and mutual admiration that developed between Byron and Shelley. Genuine friendship and admiration, Byron and Shelley. And at this time, Shelley wrote Julian and Medello about that relationship he had with Byron. Julian and Medello is by Shelley. Mary Shelley also started to write Frankenstein, The Modern Prometheus. In 1818, it was published. And once when they visited Chateau de Chillon, they visited the prison called Chateau de Chillon. The story of Francois Bonivard, a 16th century Swiss patriot who was imprisoned there for his defense of the freedom of Geneva. He was a freedom fighter for Geneva. Francois Bonivard was a freedom fighter for Geneva. And he was imprisoned in the Chateau de Chillon, the prison of Chillon. That story of Francois Bonivard, the 16th century Swiss patriot, imprisoned for his defense of the freedom of Geneva, inspired Byron to write The Prisoner of Chillon. Byron's Prisoner of Chillon is a story of Francois Bonnivard. And here, I told you, Byron also wrote the third canto of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, 1816. And the fourth canto would only appear in 1818. The Prisoner of Chillon is a long dramatic monologue. The Prisoner of Chillon is a long dramatic monologue about political tyranny. And it begins with Sonnet on Chillon. Francois Bonnivard is shackled or chained to a pillar by civil authorities for his religious beliefs. His religious beliefs, which led to his political interventions, are against the authorities. And this character of Francois Bonnivard reminds us of the mythical Prometheus, who was also a rebel against political tyranny. And Francois Bonnivard is shackled. He is imprisoned and chained. He is not a Byronic hero because you know why? Because he falls in love with his chains. He falls in love with his chains because only his body can be changed. Chained. His spirit cannot be chained. His mind is free. My very chains and I grew friends. So much a long communion tends to make us what we are. Even I regained my freedom with a sigh. Once I had a chicken pox and I was confined to my room for 15 days. But there I began thinking and writing, and my solitude, the time I spent alone, was quite productively spent. And when I had to move out of my room, I will not have time again to think and write like before I knew. And I posted this in Facebook. My very chains and I grew friends. So much a long communion tends to make us what we are. Even I regained my freedom with a sigh. That means, for a mind that is free, the chaining of the body is not a problem. The chainless mind cannot be imprisoned even if the body is. So this prisoner who falls in love with his chains is not a Byronic hero. Because a Byronic hero is a rebel. He will not be in love with his chains. The third canto of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage was published at this time. It is based on Byron's journey from Dover to Waterloo. And then along the Rhine to Switzerland. He's talking about his journey based on the theme of war. Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, third part is about all these things. Theme of war, his journey from Dover to Waterloo, then along the Rhine River to Switzerland. There are famous lines in the third canto of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. I have not loved the world, nor the world me. But let us part fair foes. I do believe that though I have found them not, that there may be words which are things, hopes which will not deceive, and virtues which are merciful, nor weave snares for the failing. He did not find anything good in this world. The world failed him. The world hated him. But he says he still believes that there are good things left in the world. Other famous lines here are, I live not in myself, but I become portion of all that around me. I become portion of that around me. And to me, high mountains are a feeling, but the hum of human cities torture. I live not in myself, but I become portion of that around me. He becomes a portion of everything around him. But to me, high mountains are a feeling, but the hum of human cities torture. After the Shelleys left, Geneva, John Hobhouse joined Byron, and together they toured the Alps. They went to the Alps. Meanwhile, Claremont gave birth to a daughter. Byron turned to blank verse drama at this time to purge his broodings and guilt. he wrote blank verse drama to purge his broodings and guilt. And all of Byron's plays have a Byronic hero. Blank verse drama that he wrote all have a Byronic hero. Manfred came in 1817, the year of Biographia Literaria. Manfred is a Gothic closet drama of the protagonist Manfred, tormented by a nameless guilt and remorse. Later, Castle of Otranto by Horace Walpole uses the same name Manfred, taken from Byron. Byron's Manfred is a Gothic closet drama that is meant only for reading. Manfred, the protagonist, is tormented by a nameless guilt and remorse, and he seeks forgetfulness. He dies defiantly without submitting to higher powers. This signals Byron's rejection of the Wordsworthian belief in the benevolence of nature. This signals Byron's rejection of the Wordsworthian belief in the benevolence of nature. Cain, The Two Foscari, Marino Feliero, Heaven and Earth, Sardana Palace, these are all blank verse plays of Byron. In 1816-17, Byron and Hobhouse traveled to Italy. His visit to the cell where the 16th century poet Torquato Tasso had been confined for madness inspired a dramatic monologue, The Lament of Tasso. Byron wrote The Lament of Tasso, inspired by the visit to the cell where Torquato Tasso was imprisoned. Other poems that express dissympathy for great Italian poets are The Prophecy of Dante, Francesca of Rimini, The Story of Paolo and Francesca in Hell. That is the Prophecy of Dante. Sorry, Francesca of Rimini. Francesca of Rimini is the story of Paolo and Francesca in Hell. This story is taken from Dante's Inferno. And it has been retold by Lehand as the story of Rimini. This story has been retold by Lehand as the story of Rimini. Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, Canto 4, appeared in 1818 based on his travels in Rome. On his 30th birthday, Byron met 19-year-old Countess Teresa Guiccioli. There was a 19-year-old Countess Teresa Guiccioli who inspired Byron at this time. She was the wife of a middle-aged count and the relationship was lasting. He had a lasting friendship with her. She influenced him positively. In Italy, he wrote the long poem Beppo, a Venetian story. Beppo is subtitled The Venetian Story. It's a long poem. 1817. What is the story? Beppo, a Venetian merchant, returns home after years of Turkish captivity. He had been held captive in Turkey. He returns home to discover that his wife Laura had taken account for her lover. The three pleasantly form a love triangle. He does not go away. He just joins his wife and lover. This poem is not dark like earlier stories. The tormented hero with his pride and pessimism is replaced with witty, cynical hero. And it was influenced by this poem, was influenced by the relaxed moral code of Italy. There was no strict morality there. He used ottava rima in this poem. Ottava rima is 8 lines of iambic pentameter. Favorite meter of Byron. He used ottava rima in this poem for the first time, which later became his predominant meter. Mazeppa came in 1819. It's a poem based on a story told by Voltaire. He took the story of Mazeppa from Voltaire. Swedish King Charles the 12th and his officers are resting after a war. And Mazeppa is telling his life story to them. Are you following? This is also set in Italy. No, is it Italy? Swedish king. Mazeppa was page to the Polish king. His affair with a wealthy man's wife was discovered. And he was put on a mad horse's back and chased away. He escapes after the horse falls dead. He escapes after the horse falls dead. Mazeppa, 1819. Very important is Don Juan, 1821. Don Juan is a serio-comic poem. It is written in the tone of Beppo. Same tone, serio-comic tone. Don Juan is the story of the legendary libertine. Libertine means one who has relaxed moral code. Womanizer kind of. Don Juan is a satiric, picaresque novel in verse. Don Juan is a satiric, picaresque novel in verse. It is about a picaro. It is a novel but in poetry. And it's a mock epic. Byron called it an epic satire. Byron himself called Don Juan an epic satire. Probably it was inspired by Don Quixote and Orlando Furioso. Don Quixote of Cervantes and Orlando Furioso of Ariosto. Remember, Orlando Furioso was also the source of Fairy Queen. In Byron's Don Juan, the legend is reversed. The Spanish legend is of Don Juan who seduces women. But here we have women seducing Don Juan. In Byron's poem, Don Juan is someone easily seduced by women. He's a naive hero. His travels and accidental adventures, sexual adventures, are discussed. Don Juan begins with a dedication to Robert Sade. Because that means Byron is attacking Sade for prostituting himself to the establishment. Sade was a radical, but now he has become a poet laureate. He is attacking Sade. And William Wordsworth also is attacked because he was also a radical turned conservative. There are 16 completed cantos and the 17th is unfinished. The whole of human race comes under the lash of Byron. It is the fullest expression of Byron's complex personality. Don Juan is the fullest expression of Byron's complex personality. The poem Don Juan was published cautiously by John Murray, without the poet's name anonymously, and without his savage dedication to the poet laureate Robert Sade. John Murray did not put the savage dedication to Robert Sade. Many critics, especially in the Blackwoods magazine, attacked it with great fury. Don Juan was widely attacked. However, Walter Scott, Goethe, Shelley, etc. appreciated it. Goethe at this time started a correspondence with Byron. He appreciated Byron. And Byron dedicated Sardana Palace. Remember his blank verse play, Sardana Palace? It was dedicated to Goethe. Goethe honored Byron in the second part of Faust, where Byron appears as Euphorion, the child of Faust and Helen. Byron is made into a character, Euphorion. He appears as Euphorion, the child of Faust and Helen in the second part of Faust, the play by Goethe, 1832. Later years of Byron. Byron was at this time certainly the most famous nobleman in Europe. Though he was in exile from England, Byron followed English political, literary and domestic affairs with keen interest. He kept up his correspondence with his friends in England. In 1818, he began his memoirs, remembering his personal life, which he handed over to his future biographer, Thomas Moore, who visited him in Venice. This work was, however, burnt without publication because it was scandalous. After his death, as per the wishes of Hobhouse and Augusta, the two intimate people of Byron, this memoirs was burnt. Under the influence of Teresa Guiccioli, who is now separated from her husband, Byron became virtuous, healthy, and happy. She had a very positive influence on Byron. The antagonism between Byron and Sadhe was an old one. I told you that from the first English Bards and Scotch Reviewers, they were fighting. In 1821 appeared Sadhe's A Vision of Judgment, a thoroughly Tory poem or conservative poem, imagining the soul of the recently deceased, means dead, King George III triumphantly entering heaven. King George III has died and his soul is entering heaven. That is the theme of Sadhe's A Vision of Judgment. Remember, Sadhe was a poet laureate. And he had to write for the throne. But he unnecessarily attacked Byron. The preface to Sadhe's work, A Vision of Judgment, was an onslaught upon Don Juan. It attacked Don Juan. And there was a reference to its author as the founder of the Satanic school. Sadhe referred to Byron as the founder of the Satanic school. Will Byron keep quiet? No. Byron wrote the very effective rejoinder, The Vision of Judgment, 1822. If Sadhe wrote A Vision of Judgment, Byron wrote The Vision of Judgment. After that, there is no vision. It is final. The Vision of Judgment. It was published in Leigh Hunt's magazine, The Liberal. Leigh Hunt was publishing The Liberal at this time. Byron, Shelley, Leigh Hunt all together started this periodical, and Shelley died at this time. Byron's poem, The Vision of Judgment, is from a Whig point of view and shows the real plight of George III's soul. It is far from what Sadhe envisaged, according to Byron. Byron and Teresa were now involved with Carbonari, the militant nationalist movement in Italy. At this time, Italian reunification was happening. It was a political movement. All the different parts of Italy were being reunified. Risorgimento, that is what it is called. Please read our European History in a Day book. There I have discussed Risorgimento and other events like that. Also, read the encyclopedia along with this. The movement was soon put to an end in Italy. And Byron and Teresa had to flee from the city of Ravenna to Pisa. Byron and his friend Teresa had to escape from one city to another. In 1821, Byron embraced the cause of Greek nationalism, an interest which was apparent in Childe Harold as well as Don Juan. Greek nationalism was a theme in Childe Harold as well as Don Juan. Byron went to Greece and worked ceaselessly for Greek independence from Turkish rulers. He went to Greece, even though later Keats also wrote about Greece. He never went to Greece, but Byron went to Greece and he worked ceaselessly for Greek independence from Turkish rulers. For the Greeks, Byron is a national hero. Greeks regarded him as a national hero. In 1824, Byron caught rheumatic fever after being soaked to the skin in an open boat. And he died on 19th April. His death anniversary is coming up. The Greeks wanted to bury him in Athens, but his body was taken to England, only to be denied burial at the Westminster Abbey. Because he led a profligate life, I suppose. He was buried finally in the family vault at Nottinghamshire. It was a shock to many people, including Tennyson. Tennyson, then a boy of 14, heard the news of Byron's death and said, "The whole world darkened to me." On a rock near his house, poor Tennyson inscribed, "Byron is dead." The Byronic hero has gothic elements. He has conflicting emotions or moodiness, mood swings. He is self-critical and introspective, struggles with integrity. Other people question his integrity. He is introspective, moody. He has a distaste for social institutions and norms, like the angry young man later. He does not quietly succumb to social institutions. He's an outcast, an exile, an outlaw. It's like Satan. He shows lack of respect for rank and privilege. He has a troubled past. He is cynical, demanding, and arrogant, and often self-destructive. He has troubles with sexual identity, and he's a loner rejected from society. Byronic hero is a loner rejected from society. So that's all about Byron. Next, we have to do a video on P.B. Shelley. Until then, goodbye.